Now, that was a powerful time of worship, wasn't it? That was a powerful time. That was a powerful time in God's presence. But good news, it doesn't stop now, right? It's only just beginning. Well, hi, everybody. My name is Vlad. I am a leader here. And I'm just so thankful you guys are here. You guys are a real beautiful group. You guys are beautiful. And you guys don't hear it enough. You guys don't get to hear it enough that you guys are beautiful. You guys are made in the image of God. So you guys are beautiful. I'm glad you guys are here. Thanks for choosing to spend your Tuesday here with us. You could have been doing something else. You could have been playing Fortnite. I know Dominic wants to play some Fortnite when he gets home, but we're thankful that you're here. So this is our youth group, and all it's about is to help you guys get one step closer to God. That's all we're about. That's all these four walls are built for, and that's what's going on this Friday. You guys know what's going on this Friday? We got Dynamis. We got Dynamis, and it's just going to be just like this. Just an opportunity for you guys to be able to experience God in a life-changing, radical way. Maybe you're in here and you just feel as if you just stumbled on in here and it's just another day and it's just another Tuesday. Well, guess what? I bet Peter, when he went fishing, Simon Peter, it was just another day for him when he met Jesus that one day. It was just another day. He just stumbled into that boat. But that's the day he met Jesus. And that's the day Jesus said, hey, Peter, Simon, follow me. I will teach you to be fishers of men. And his whole life changed and the whole world changed. When I came here 4 years ago, I just stumbled on in here. I didn't expect anything. It was just a normal day for me. But I encountered the presence of God and I met someone named Jesus. I didn't understand it. I didn't. But I just experienced the love like it just made no sense. And I'm like, something's weird going on here in this church. Let me come back. So if you're feeling that way, you just stumbled in here. You're here for a reason. And let me assure you guys, God has something for every single one of you. Even the ones in the back, it doesn't matter where you're sitting. It doesn't matter where you're sitting. God has something for you. He has something for you, and he wants to speak to your life directly, and he wants to speak to your circumstances, and he wants to speak to your storms that you're facing. So I just wanted to start off in prayer. There's no better way to start anything than prayer. So Lord, Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this opportunity. We thank you that we're here. We thank you that we're alive. Hallelujah for that one. I just pray against all distractions right now. The enemy is going to try to speak, and we just tell him to go away in the name of Jesus. He has no voice here tonight. He has no voice here tonight. We just ask that you just speak. We open our minds. We open our hearts to you, God. We just allow you to speak to us. You're speaking. It's just a matter of whether we're listening. And I just pray that we're able to hear your voice today. God, speak to us. Touch us, God. Just one touch is all we need. In your holy name, amen. So we're in the season called Walking on the Water. And Neko was talking to us last week about finding peace amongst the storm. That's not easy. That's not easy. So today what I'm going to be talking about is how God gets you through the storms. And then just, I think it was last week, Aziz asked me, hey, what are you going to be talking about on Tuesday? And I said, I'm going to be talking about how God gets you through the storms. And he was like, perfect. You're going through a whole lot of them, so this is perfect. I was like, thanks, Aziz, for the fantastic encouragement. I really appreciate that. But seriously, he did encourage me. So if you ever need encouragement, he's your guy to go to. He's your guy to go to. So I wanted to read a scripture out of the Bible. Luke chapter 8, verse 20. So if you guys could go on your phones or your physical Bibles and go on the YouVersion or whatever app you have and go to Luke chapter 8, verse 20. And as you guys are getting there, I just wanted to encourage you guys to take notes because God speaks. And then we have bad memories, right? Anyone like me, you just forget things. And God's speaking some things to you specifically, and chances are if you don't write them down, we forget. Like, we leave here so encouraged and filled up, but when we get home, we're like, this happened. What did he say? I don't know what he said. I mean, that's why the Bible was written down, because if he just spoke it, we would forget, right? So here it is. This is the Bible verse that Neko was talking about last week, and I just wanted to say it again. So it's Luke chapter 8. Verses 22. This is what it says. The context is Jesus. He's with his disciples. That's basically the context. One day, Jesus said to his disciples, let's go over to the other side of this lake. So they got into the boat and set out. As they sailed, Jesus, he fell asleep. A squall came down. I don't know what that was, so I searched it up. A squall is a violent wind. There's a new word for you guys. Word of the day. A squall came down on the lake. So that the boat was being swamped. The boat was flooding. So they were in great danger. Then the disciples went and woke Jesus up saying, Master, Master, we're going to drown. Can you just imagine this? The boat's overflowing. there's a huge squall coming down, and the disciples go to Jesus. Jesus, we're going to drown. Jesus, we're going to die. Jesus, we're going to die. Your ministry is over. All that you worked for is done. You said we're going to reach the end of the world, but Jesus, we're going to die right now. What are we going to do? And this is what happens. Jesus wakes up. He gets up, and he rebuked the wind. He stopped it and the raging waters, and the storm subsided, and all was calm. Where is your faith? He asked the disciples. Where is your faith? And I relate to that story. I don't know if you guys do, but when storms get heavy, like mom's spaghetti, I tend to freak out. I tend to freak out real bad. Just the other day, I tried on a new coffee shop that was a little closer, and they got my drink wrong. And that was a big storm in my life. I got home, and I'm like, man, God, I like my drink a specific way, with specific flavors, with a specific type of milk, and a specific type of ice, amount of ice, no more. And if anything's wrong, I can't continue my day. My day's over, God. I don't even want to continue this day. I just want to go back to sleep. We tend to freak out when storms, when things happen, when things don't go our way, right? So I don't know if you guys relate to the disciples, but all right, this is where I was wanting to go. So Jesus doesn't want us to freak out when our storms come. He doesn't. That's why Jesus was sleeping in that boat. And I'm going through some storms in life. And you guys as leaders are going through storms in life. You guys as pastors are going through storms in life. And a storm is what Neko was saying last week. It's a difficulty in life. It's something that doesn't go your way. It's something that's really challenging. And you just look up to the clouds and you're like, stop. Like yesterday I was trying to see that solar eclipse. And I'm looking up at the clouds and I'm like, move clouds, what are we doing? I just want to see the solar eclipse. That was a storm in my life. And I don't know if you guys have ever been in like an actual storm. Well, you live in Spokane, so obviously. But last February, I went to Los Angeles with our one college. We went on a mission trip there. But Aziz, Peter, and I, we went a couple days earlier because we wanted to experience the LA sunshine. I wanted to get that tan coming back looking like I just got from Cancun. I wanted to get tan. I wanted to enjoy that sun. And we got there, and it was great when we got there. It was sun in, right, Peter? It was great. Peter was taking his socks off, walking on the beach. It was nice. It was nice. But later that day, we were driving on the highway, and then we start to see signs, and they say, severe weather storm incoming for the rest of the week. And we look at each other, and we start laughing. Severe weather warning in California. What's going to happen? It's going to get a little cloudy. We were just laughing amongst ourselves. And an hour later, there was no laughing going on. It was pouring cats and dogs, full grown. And I didn't even have a jacket. Full grown. I didn't even have a jacket. I was basically wearing like things like this, just a t-shirt. That was a storm. Guess what? The city was flooding. There was water this high. The city was flooding. And we're like, what are we doing? Is this Los Angeles or are we in Seattle? What's going on here? So that storm made that mission trip really difficult. Pastor Ryan's like, all right, we're going to go outside and we're going to go feed the homeless. We're going to go invite them to the Dream Center. And we're like, what do you mean by go outside? Like outside the room or like outside? What do you mean by that? So we were outside the entire week, drenched in water. It just didn't stop. So storms are really difficult and they make things really challenging. And on a serious note, there's storms that we're going through in life. And I just wanted just to take an opportunity for you guys to close your eyes for a second. You guys can just close your eyes. Before I delve into how God could practically help you guys get through your storms, I just wanted for you guys to think about some of the storms that you're going through in life. Maybe it's family. Your family's not going well. Maybe it's your relationships. Maybe you're feeling lonely and that you're alone and that nobody likes you and that no one wants to spend time with you and you don't know why. Maybe you feel as if you haven't accomplished enough in life so far and that's weighing heavy on you. Think about what is that storm in your life? What is that thing that is making your life really difficult? What is that that's laying heavy on your heart? I know I got a few. Chances are you got some too. So you guys could open up your eyes. And I just wanted to give you guys three practical ways that God could get you through your storms. God could get you through your storms in a million different ways, but I'm only going to give you three today. So if you're taking notes, step number one, or not a step, but way number one, let's see if it's going to pop up here. Drum roll, please. Drum roll, the full armor of God. The full armor of God. This is a big one, and I bet most of us in here don't even put it on every day. I bet most of us don't even know what the full armor of God is. And see, God, he knew life was going to be tough. He knew there was going to be storms that are going to try to hurt us and going to try to take us down. So he gave us the full armor of God. Because he knows we're soldiers out here. Just imagine a soldier in the middle of a war zone with just a t-shirt and flip-flops. He's going to get hurt or he's going to die. So the Lord gave us the full armor of God. And I just wanted to encourage you guys today to start putting it on every single day. It's a big deal. He didn't just give us the full armor of God for, because he had nothing better to do. So every day how I start my day, whether I just wake up or whether I'm driving to work or driving to church, is how I start. I say, Lord, I put on the full armor of God today. I put on salvation as my helmet. Salvation as my helmet. I know that the old life is gone and the new life has begun. I know that. I know that. I know that my old self, my sin has been crucified with Christ on the cross. And it's no longer I who live, but he who lives in me, Lord. I put on the chest plate of righteousness. Righteousness means right with God. I am made right with God because of what Jesus did on that cross. Therefore, I could have a relationship with you, Father. I put on the chest plate of righteousness. I put on the belt of truth. Knowing the truth will set you free, God. I need to be set free from a lot of things. So I put on the belt of truth, Jesus. I need your truth in my life. There's a lot of lies that I'm believing God, so I put on the belt of truth. And then you know, you always got to have good shoes, so I put on the shoes of peace. The shoes of peace, for Jesus says, I leave you with a gift of peace of mind and heart. Anybody need that in here? Only a couple of us need peace of mind and heart. I need peace of mind and heart. There's a lot of things going on, so I put on the shoes of peace. I put on the shoes of peace that come with the gospel. And guess what else Jesus said? This peace that I leave you, the world cannot give. The world cannot give you this peace. It can't. It's easy to believe that. It's easy to believe that, man, if I have a girlfriend, my life will be peaceful. It's easy to believe, man, if I have the job of my dreams, I'll be peaceful. It sounds peaceful to me if I make the NBA and I win a championship every single year I play. That sounds pretty peaceful. If I had a lot of money, Jesus says the world cannot give you this peace. So I put on the shoes of peace. And then guess what, y'all? We're not done yet. I pick up the shield of faith. The shield of faith. And this is what the Bible says, what it will do. It will protect you from the fiery arrows of the enemy. Guess what, y'all? We're in spiritual warfare, every single one of us, whether we even know it or not, whether we see it or not, whether we feel it or not, or whether we even believe it or not. That doesn't change the fact that we're in spiritual warfare. The enemy's trying to take us down with his fiery arrows and much more tactics. He's trying to take us down. So we pick up that shield of faith, our faith in the Lord. God, I don't know what tomorrow may hold. God, I don't know. But I choose to believe. I choose to believe in you, that you're my God. I put on that shield of faith. And then my favorite, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Hallelujah for that one. We're not just playing defense. We're soldiers. We're called to fight. So he gave us the sword of the Spirit, which is what the word of God. And this is the perfect segue into point number two. You see what I did there? Point number two, the word of God. The word of God gets us through the storms of life. How? Why? How can we stand on God's promises if we don't even know what they are? How? We can't. That's the easy answer for you. We can't. See, God has over 7,000 promises in the Bible for you specifically. Not just for your mom, not just for your dad, for you specifically. Over thousands upon thousands of promises for you in your life personally. How many do we know? Well, half of one. There's thousands upon thousands. See, Aziz, Peter, and I, we got a new house, a rental house. Okay, nothing crazy. We're renting a house. And for whatever reason, this house did not come with a washer and dryer. Why does a rental place not come with a washer and dryer? So, yeah, exactly. What in the world? So I invite my dad over, and I mention to him, hey, Dad, we don't got a washer and dryer. And he says, that's interesting. Try to find one online. I'll get you one. And I'm like, all right, perfect. So guess what I did? Hey, Dad, how you doing today? It's your favorite son calling. Sorry, Eric. It's your favorite son calling. And you said that you'd give me a washer and dryer. So how are we looking on that? Shoot him a text a couple days later of some washer and dryers I found online. Hey, Dad, these look nice. What are your thoughts on these? I go over to his house. Hey, Dad, you see, I have to use your washer and dryer because I don't have one. I don't got one. And anyways, last time I was there, I was doing laundry. And I said, hey, Dad, how are we looking on that washer and dryer? And he said, well, I know a guy. I know a Russian guy. I have a connection with him. We can get in touch with him. All right, when? How about this Saturday? Okay, all right, what time? We could do 10 o'clock. All right, are you going to come pick me up 10 o'clock? All right, guess what? That Saturday, he picked me up, and he got me a washer and dryer. I held him at his word, and our God is the same way. Our God is the same way. He has things promised to you, just like my dad promised a washer and dryer. He has things promised for you. And he loves it when we take him at his word. God, you said this. You said that I have the free gift of peace. It's about time I experience some of that. God, you say that by your wounds I am healed. It's time that I experience that. I take you at your word, God. I choose to believe. I choose to have faith. God, your word says this. Your God, he has so many promises to us. And this is the year of the Bible, is it not? It's the year of the Bible. That's what our church's emphasis is on the Bible. And in there, man, I just encourage you guys to start digging in there. Start finding the promises. Start finding the thousands upon thousands of promises and start taking God at his word. God, you say this. God, you said this. It works. He loves it. He won't get mad. He's not an angry God. Someone once said, which is absolutely true, God's not in a bad mood. Someone needed to hear that. God's not in a bad mood. He's never in a bad mood. He's always in a wonderful mood. Always. Always. So God won't be upset when you take him at his word. He gets really excited. He gets really excited, and he just wants to bless you. He really wants to bless you. You're his child. You're his child. And our identity also comes from the word. Our identity comes from the word. It doesn't come from what we wear, who we're with, what we've done. Our identity comes from the Bible. See, identity is a tree, right? And a branch of that tree is your security, whether you're secure or insecure. Our identity comes from that. And guess what the Bible says about you guys? You guys are children. Just as Aziz was talking about earlier, you guys are children of God. Ladies in here, you guys have been mislabeled your entire life. But you're a child of God. You are a daughter of God. Nothing less. You are nothing less than that. Doesn't matter what anybody says. You are a daughter of God. That's who you are. You are made in his image. You are beautiful. You are made in his image. God knit you together in your mother's womb. He took time on you. You're not a waste of time. You are made in the image of God. And God has so much for you. God has so much for you. And my guys in here, you guys are sons. You guys are sons of God. You're not a failure. You're not. You guys are champions. It's hard to believe that. It's hard to see that. But you are a champion. You're a son of God and you're an heir to the kingdom. That's what Aziz was talking about earlier. He showed us the proof in the word. If you don't believe it, that's what it said in the word. You guys are heirs. You guys are princes. You guys are champions. We can't settle for anything less. Our identity comes from the Bible. It's so easy to identify ourselves with what we've done, how we look like, whether or not we have successful parents. That's not where our identity comes from. It comes from the word. And then number three, this is the hardest one. Number three, I don't really like it. Number three, it's harder than the first two combined, multiplied, squared to the power of eight. It's really difficult. And that is trust. Trust gets us through the storms of life. See, if the disciples just trusted Jesus, they would have no need to freak out. Jesus is sleeping and he ain't worried. Why should I be? See, Jesus never promised, when you give your life to Jesus, all your problems will go away. See, that's what I thought. I thought when I raised my hand and gave my life to Jesus that my problems would go away. And they didn't. So I'm like, you know what? All right, when I get baptized, surely they will go away. And they didn't. So, man, did my baptism not work? Something's going on here. Why do I still have storms in life? See, Jesus never said, come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will make your problems go away in a snap of a finger. Welcome to paradise. No, he said, come to me, all who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, for it is easy to bear, and the burden I give is light. I will give you rest. See, the disciples, they were freaking out. But what Jesus would have been absolutely fine with is say, hey, you could come in this room with me. Why don't you just sit down and let's rest together? I will give you rest. Let's just rest. Trust is really hard. There's a saying, and it's pretty true, that our life is a canvas. You guys know what a canvas is? It's like a blank white rectangle that painters paint on, right? Our life is a canvas, and God holds the paintbrush. That's how it was designed to be. But we, for whatever reason, really like holding the paintbrush. We think that we're artists. We think that we know what's best. Like, we think we really know what's best. Like, this relationship, the other ones have failed, but this one, God, I got a good feeling about this one. I got a good feeling about this one. It's really hard. See, when we hold the paintbrush in our hands, we take it from God. See, God is working on this canvas of our lives. He has different spots. This is your relationships. This is your family. This is your future. And he's working on it, and he's working on it. And we just go ahead and take that paintbrush away and say, nah, I think I know what's best. It's really easy. See, what trust is, trust is saying, God, have the paintbrush. I choose to trust you no matter how long it takes. Trust is really hard. Trust is really hard because sometimes it makes no sense. Sometimes it makes no sense. And the hardest thing to trust, you guys ready? It's almost like when we hear this, it's like this feeling that we get. Trusting in God's timing. Whew, that's a tough one. God's timing, that usually includes waiting. And we don't like waiting, do we? Am I the only one in here? Starbucks takes longer than 3 minutes. And I'm like, okay, what's going on here? I'm about to write a bad review, okay? Like, or I'm in the line at Chick-fil-A and I order my food and they're taking a bit longer than usual. And I'm like about to go in and say, hey, did you guys forget my order? I've been waiting for a little bit too long now. See, waiting is hard. And waiting is also a storm. A storm of waiting. But it's like still and quiet. And we're like, how much longer do I got to wait? When is something going to actually happen? And waiting, there's good things in waiting. See, waiting, the season of waiting, waiting helps us become the person we need to become for God to use us the way he wants to use us. That's what it does. Waiting, the season of waiting, helps us become the person that we need to become so God could take us on the adventures he wants to take us on. So he could take us to meet the people he wants us to meet. Wink, wink, wink. He wants us to become the person we need to become so we could experience the things we need to experience, to go the places we need to go. Waiting is hard. I don't know if you're anything like me. Waiting is hard. I want to find the right person today and get married tomorrow. That's me. But that doesn't sound too wise, does it? No. And while we're on that topic, it's something that we're always thinking about, right? Something that we're always thinking about, might be even thinking of right now. We really want a girlfriend or a boyfriend. And that's good, right? God created us to have that longing. But sometimes, in that area in particular, we really like to hold the paintbrush. We're like, God, no. I want full control in this area. I want full control in this area. But have you ever thought that God is working something in you right now and in your future partner? And you just need to trust him in his timing? Let me say that one more time. I think the microphone cut out. God is working something in you and in your future partner, and you just need to trust him in his timing. Stop taking the paintbrush. And if no one relates to this, this is perfect for me. This is absolutely perfect for me. Absolutely perfect. It's so easy to want to take the paintbrush, and trust is so hard, but trust gets us through the storms of life. Trusting God, trusting Christ. All right, let's see where I'm at. Let's see where I was sidetracked. You guys like the silence? It's a lot quieter than my small group. There's no silence in that. I'm leading a middle school boys, and there is no silence in that. No silence. And I won't point any fingers, but I'll say names, Jeremiah and Chance. These guys, they don't stop talking. I love you guys. See, I just wanted to remind you guys that God is more concerned about who you are becoming than where you're going. We're so focused on where we're going than who we are becoming. It's flipped. But God is more concerned about who you are becoming than where you're going. And that's why we're having these seasons of waiting. That's why we're having these seasons. Like school, for example, that's a tough season. And it's a season that doesn't seem to ever end. It just never ends. I thought it was over. See, matter of fact, I wanted to drop out of high school my junior year. I wanted to drop out because I was so tired and so done with this season of school. But guess what? God had other plans. I was like, God, hold the paintbrush. Here you go. Now, with his fantastic artwork, I'm in college. Wow, can't believe that's happening. And I can't believe I haven't failed yet. That's a miracle. Do you guys believe in miracles here? I can't believe that. That's wild. See, God does if that is proof that God does do miracles. If anyone doesn't believe in miracles, I haven't failed. And that's a storm. And I know a lot of you guys are tired of school, and you're done, and you're ready to throw in the towel. He wants to leave. He wants to leave. That's a storm. And that's a storm that is like has everything mixed together. Stress, people. Oh, don't get me started with people. Anything that has to do with people is really stormy. Really stormy. God, what is wrong with this person, God? Can you give me an explanation? Because things don't make sense. They just make my life harder, God. They make my life so much harder. Can you just find a way to remove them out of my life? People are really stormy. Relationships are stormy. And don't get me started on family. Family is really stormy. Family's stormy. I got a lot of my family here today. And that's pretty awesome. My brother just got baptized last Sunday. That's awesome. But it hasn't all been sunshine and rainbows. It's been storms among storms and maybe a little glimmer of light. I'll tell you that much. And that's what families usually are. See, families oftentimes are the people you didn't choose to be a part of your life, but they're there and they don't go away. There's no better way to explain it. You didn't choose. And holidays come around, Easter. Literally, I was just telling Aziz this. Like, I love my family. I love my family. I pray for them every day. But I was telling Aziz, I'm like, Aziz, too much family, bro. I saw them for Easter and on Sunday for Eric's baptism. Too much family. And then for the lunch after Eric's baptism, like, oh, that is a whole lot of family in a whole short period of time, especially for me. The family, yeah, people are stormy. That's the point I was trying to make. People are stormy, and we got to trust God through that, too. We got to trust God through that, too, because we're humans, and we're imperfect, and we're really imperfect. So let me go check real quick if I didn't miss anything. I know I'm going over here a lot. Okay, I think I did a pretty decent job. So do you guys remember point number one? Full armor of God. Full armor of God. I know you're going through storms. You guys are going through storms. And if you're not, what boat are you on and how could I get on it? Please, 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 please. It's easy to put on a smile here. It's easy to be joyful here. We're around our friends and our family, and we're thinking about good things. We're thinking about Jesus and how good he is. But as soon as we get home, and as soon as we're alone by ourselves, all those things come back. All the realities of life come back. And it's not easy. And I just wanted to encourage you guys today. Here in a few minutes, we're going to have our leaders come up. And they've experienced storms. And we want to pray over you guys. Let's have a time of humility and a time of vulnerability where we could say, hey, you know what? This is a storm that I'm going through in my life. And it doesn't go away. And I need help. I need help. Let's put on the full armor of God. If you don't know what it is, it's in the Ephesians chapter 6. Memorize it. Put it as your wallpaper. That's what I did. You don't just memorize things like that. Some people do. Pastor Jim, he's really good at memorizing scripture. He's fantastic. But it's memorizing scripture for some of us doesn't come really easily. So find it, memorize it, and put it on every day. I put on the full armor of God. Even if you don't feel a difference It's spiritual warfare that's going on. And God made it for a reason, not on accident. Number two.
If I have a testimony.
Boom. Read the Bible. How can we stand on God's promises if we don't even know what they are? How? It's time that we get in the Word and start to learn what His promises are. Learn what His promises are so we can get through life, so we can keep going. So we can keep going. Remember David? Remember David? Remember the story of David? It was spoken over him that his family would bow down before him out of respect. And guess what happened next? He became a slave. Storms happen in life. David went through a lot of storms. And there's a lot of people in the Bible that have gone through storms. And we can learn from their stories and take courage and learn what God's promises are. See, it's promised to you that the kingdom of heaven is yours. You belong to the kingdom of heaven. Matter of fact, you guys are citizens of the kingdom of heaven. We're aliens here on this planet Earth. We're aliens. We don't belong to this place. We belong to the kingdom of heaven. To the kingdom of heaven. We have so much, so much. I can't even say all the things that God has for us in if I started now and I took an entire year. I couldn't. And then number three, trust. God, I give you the paintbrush. I know it sounds silly. But God, I choose to trust you in your timing. Every time I try myself, it doesn't work. Every time I choose to trust my own abilities, it doesn't work. Every time I choose to trust my own wisdom, it doesn't work. It doesn't. Let's trust God. And not just like how it says on the t-shirt, trust God, bro. It's much deeper. I just wanted to pray over you guys. If you guys could just close your eyes and bow your heads.
I found my joy.
God, we thank you for the safe place to experience your presence. All jokes aside, we're going through things. We're here once, maybe twice a week. But in reality, we're going through things and we got storms and we just feel like giving up. We feel so frustrated. God, why are these storms happening to me? Why do I get treated this way? Why do these people speak these things to me? Why do I look this way, God, and this person looks this way? Why do I sound this way, God, and this person sounds this way? God, why am I part of this family, but this person is a part of this family? Why do I go to this school? Why am I still in this school? Why am I still in this city? I'm tired of it. So many things, God. So many things that lay heavy on us. And there might be some of you guys in here that haven't really experienced Jesus. Haven't really met Him. Haven't really been saved by Him. See, before Jesus, we were all living in darkness. And when we gave our life to Jesus and said, Jesus, I want you, He snatches us out of darkness. He snatches us out of darkness. And there are some of you guys that are living in darkness. And that you just want to be saved and snatched out of it. And just in a moment here, I'm going to give you guys an opportunity to receive Jesus. How? How do you get saved? How do you get saved? The Bible says all you have to do is believe. All you have to do is believe. It's so easy. And I'm going to ask you guys to raise your hand. If that's you, may not be you, that's okay. But if that is you, when you raise your hand, that's you just saying, I believe. I believe today's the day I want to get saved. So if that's you, on the count of three, I want Jesus. I choose to believe. I want to be saved. Raise your hand. One, two, three. I see your hand. I see your hand too. I see your hand. I see your hand as well. I see those three as well. You guys may put your hands down. Jesus is entering your hearts right now. Jesus is snatching you out of the darkness, whether you feel it or not. Life is not about a feeling. Choices lead, feelings follow. And you just chose and made the best decision of your life to accept Jesus as your personal Savior. And right now, the Holy Spirit is entering within you and sealing Himself in your soul. You're not going to leave here the same. You're not going to leave here the same. For you are now what? A son of God. You are now what? A daughter of God. That's who you are. You are no longer living in sin, for that sin has been crucified on that cross with Jesus. You have a new identity now. It's not just you who lives, it's Christ who lives in you. We just thank you, Jesus. Amen.